And mighty God, put my trust in you. You are able to get your other stuff queued up. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. 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 It seems so quiet. I'm about to get on y'all nerves. It's all right. One thing I learned to do, one thing I learned to understand, that there are times when it seems like you're in the wrong area or just something ain't right. What I'm talking about from up here, from a perspective of where I'm standing at and where I'm coming from. And it's like, well, what it seems like in here, I know maybe it's the weather. It's been raining a lot. It rained for most of the month of September. We had a few sunny days so far in this first 7 days of October, and here we are again, where the sun might not be seen, but the sun is still shining. Mm-hmm. In spite of the clouds in the sky, when you raise up above the clouds, the sun still shines. When you raise up above your situation, the sun is still shining. When you raise up above your circumstances, the sun, S-O-N, is still shining. In spite of what we go through, the sun is still shining. In spite of where we're standing at, the sun is still shining. In spite of what we see, in spite of what might be standing in between us and the sun that's throwing a shade in our direction, the sun is still shining. As a matter of fact, even as David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. In other words, the sun is still shining, even though death is standing there in between me and the sun, because in order for a shadow to be casted, something must be standing in front of the light. So the light is there even in the midst of my despair and my situation. And see, I don't know about y'all, and whether you're listening or not, I don't know, but I'm getting myself. As David said, you have to encourage yourself in the Lord. When they sought to kill him and to stone him, and he found himself alone, and he had to talk to God and encourage himself in the Lord. And if this message that I'm preaching today is just for me to make me happy and to make me cut a rug and do a little dance, then guess what? You can sit there, you can watch me get happy and stand up and cut a little rug, or you can join in with me. But I think by the time the end of it is done, what we came to do is to put a praise on it.
Yes.
There's a song, a very popular song by Tasha Cobbs and Kiara Shear, that says, I'm going to put a praise on it. Says there's a miracle in this room with my name on it. There's a breakthrough, there's a healing, there's deliverance, and I'm going to put a praise on it. But there are a lot of things in life that I'm going through, that we're going through, that in order for me to get through, I need to put a praise on it. See, there are situations that rise up where things ain't always easy. Forget my grammar, throw it out the window. For all you scholarly people and you teachers, it's going to be a lot of ain'ts and whatever else in there. I ain't come this morning to be grammatically correct. I came to get the word out and to get a message that there are times, especially times like now, where every time you go somewhere, turn on something, there is nothing but gloom and doom and bad news. I get tired of watching our local news channels, because every time I turn it on, I always hear a sentence that starts off where there was another bad night in the city of Philadelphia, and they go through 4 to 5 different stories where someone was shot and or killed. And it seems a lot like it's a lot of the young men are teenagers that are being destroyed, that are being taken out, not just in the wee hours of the night where you're used to hearing something at 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, but this craziness is happening at 2:30, 3 o'clock in the afternoon in broad daylight. People are becoming brazen and just doing and killing and whatever. But I come to tell you one thing, that yes, even in the midst of all that, you can still praise him. Why? Because God's word is true. When he said that in the last and evil days, that hearts would wax cold one against another, that the fathers would turn against the sons and the daughters against their mothers, and brothers' love for each other would become almost non-existent, to the point where you'll see senseless killings and things of that nature. But why should I, as a believer, give praise? Why should I put praise on it? Well, because of God's word and his promises. Because I believe that there is a better time coming. dwelling, when God shall crack the sky and we all shall be called up to meet him in the air. So on that note alone, I can put a praise on it. I was sitting there reading and studying, and there's like 100,000 scriptures, exaggerating, but there are a lot of scriptures which talk about praise. There are actually more scriptures in the Bible that talks about praise than there is that talks about prayer. I'm not saying that praise is more important than prayer, but if God has put such an emphasis on giving his name to praise, if God has put such an emphasis on telling people about the good news, about praising him, about giving him glory, then there must be something that's important about us giving God praise. It's not just praising him with our lips. It's not just praising him in our actions. It's not just about the music. It's not just a style of song that we sing, but praise is about blessing God. As David said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. In other words, I will continue to speak good about the Lord in the land of the living, because the only way people are going to know, living in these dark times, is that we have a God who is able to keep them and to save them. So we have to put a praise on it. We have to give God the glory, honor, and the praise. See, something I found out in my studies that seemed kind of weird to me, but it might be true. And now I have to go back and look and think about it. Because when you're in a spirit of praise, I ain't even got to the text yet, but when you're in a spirit of praise and you're continually praising God and you're in a good place in the Lord, you have a tendency to sin less. Think about it. Because every time you usually fall into a place of sin, you're usually coming from a place of despair or depression, or something just ain't quite right. And when things aren't feeling right, when I walk into a spirit of complaining, I complain my way into sin. One, because I'm turning against God and I'm not having faith in whom I believe in. Second, because if my focus is on my problem, then I don't have time to give him praise. But if I have time to focus on my praise, I don't have time to worry about my problem. It's not that the problem don't go away, but you know, sometimes we need to just shut up.
Yes.
About, oh, woe is me and what I'm going through. I can't do this. I can't do that. And start singing, God, you are able. Great and mighty God, you are able. Jesus. We have to stop sitting around, oh, I can't do this. Oh, if only that. No, I thank you, God, because you can make a way. See, the problem is still there, but I have a different way of looking at it. We talked about the storm for a couple of weeks now, and the difference in the fact that when the disciples and Peter walked on water, and the storm was still going on. The word of God never said that the storm stopped when Peter started walking on the water. But notice that the shift goes to Peter, and as Peter is focused on Christ, the problem is still there, but his focus is on his praise. His focus is on the Lord who called him. And even those who were left in the ship, it does not say that they were still in the ship trembling with fear. No, because they were too busy watching the faith of someone else walking on the midst of their problem and in their situation that they began to focus on the problem solver and no longer the problem. Because somewhere in the midst of everything that was going on, Peter decided, the disciples decided, you know what, even though the storm is raging, I can put a praise on it. Because glory be to God, is that him walking in the midst of my situation? Why, yes it is. And can he call me to walk just like he walked in the midst of my situation? Well, Lord, if that's the case, then so be it.
Amen.
Put praise on it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, I'm feeling better now. I don't know about you. Psalm 100, verses 1 through 3. Book of Psalms, man. You want to get the praise on? Start reading some of them Psalms. It says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. In other words, I'm so happy. I'm so happy. Let me make a joyful noise unto the Lord. I like it when I meet them people who say, I can't sing, but I can make a joyful noise. Then you go ahead and make a joyful noise. Can't hold a tune for nothing. Tone deaf, every other kind of deaf, sound horrible, but you go on ahead and you give God praise. Make your joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands, and serve him with gladness. Be happy. Be happy. Come into his presence with singing. Wake up in the morning, Lord, I love you. Just make up a song. The word of God says so many times all throughout scripture and old and new scriptures. It says, I will sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Make up something in your head. Get yourself happy. Encourage yourself when you're feeling down. I don't know what's going on. Maybe it's the weather. I don't know. Been in the house all by myself. Maybe you got stuck on one of them channels watching something and it just felt like it sapped your spirit. Maybe it was Lifetime Movie Network and all these women going through all this stuff and got to fight this. And by the end of the day, you tired too. Felt like you've been fighting. What's going on? You got to encourage yourself in the Lord. David says, Psalm 34:1, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. His praises shall continue. I will bless him. How will I bless him? By his praises continually be in my mouth. Now sometimes we make fun of folk where every time you talk to them, you go to them and say, hey, how you doing today, brother? I'm blessed and highly favored of the Lord. I'm glad to be in his presence and wake me up this morning and good. And we sit there and we laugh. But you know what? Sometimes we need to be like that ourselves. Sometimes that need to be our response to some folk, especially them folks that give us that old grumpy good morning. You know, how you doing? You know, I get to work and I'm like, good morning. Yeah, it's Monday. Yes, it is. Like, you should be glad to be alive. And sometimes I see him on the elevator, like, I'll wait for the next one. But we need to tell him, like, you need to be happy. It's Monday. So everybody didn't have a Monday.
That's right.
You standing here complaining because you have to go to work, and there are others who are home wishing they had a job. I get it. I know sometimes I want to rest. Sometimes I don't feel like going in. It's not that I don't say it myself, like, oh, it's another Monday. And then I have to catch myself, oh, thank you, Jesus, it's another Monday. Because I tell you one thing, I'm happy when the bills show up and I'm able to pay them.
That's right.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Amen. I thank God for my bills. Not necessarily, that's the way I have to look at it. Because I'm not saying, well, God, I thank you because you gave me, helped me to get the provision so that I can take care of that which is due. I thank you, God, that I'm able to, you know, oh, I got to pay this for that. Thank you, God, because there's some people who can't. Not that I'm saying it's better than them, but God, I thank you for what I'm able to do and what you've given me the ability to do. See, sometimes those are the kind of praises that we have to have on our lips. Oh, I hate this job. I wish I could just leave this place. And then when you leave that place, you be wishing, man, I wish I still had that job. They were all of a sudden just cutting everybody loose and I got fired. Well, you've been speaking, let me go, since you've been there. Mm. And then wonder, well, why it happened? Because you didn't put praise on it. Woo, man. All right, we on the roll here. Lord, I'm just jumping. Where am I going? Let me, all right. Yeah, honey, I do have a list. She asked me, she said, did you have a list? I said, I always have a list. Somehow, sermons always turn into a list of things. You think I'd have a bunch of lists all over the house by now on how to live, just a book of lists. Maybe that's what I need to write, just a book of lists. Lord Jesus, 1 Peter 2:5, the King James Version. And I love this because it talks about early on in that chapter 2, where he starts off talking about being babes in Christ and drinking on the pure milk of the word and not on the milk of the word and not yet ready for the meat. And I love the transition that Peter makes in this book because I'm like, wow, that's awesome. He goes from babes to growing up in Christ. To watch this, he says, ye also, as lively stones or as living stones, when we now became babes in Christ, going on the milk of the word, begin to eat the meat of the word, and instead of becoming grown men and women, we've transformed into living stones and are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices, praises, acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. In other words, we are being transformed from glory to glory, from righteousness to righteousness and faith to faith, and these levels that we're building up. And we're giving God praise, the offering up a spiritual sacrifice that is holy and acceptable unto God. 1 Peter 2:9, later in that verse, he tells us, because we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth, watch this, the praises of him who have called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. See, that's the problem sometimes. I talked about this before in dealing with evangelism, that it's becoming tougher to evangelize or win a soul to Christ because people don't always realize or know or even care that it's something that they need to be saved from. It's hard to present salvation to someone who does not understand that they need to be saved. Because they're saying, well, my life is good. I'm doing this and I'm doing that. But it's not about the life you live now. It's about the life you'll live later on. What exactly are you looking for? I asked the Lord a question not too long ago. And this week he answered me. And I don't think he has anything to do with this sermon, but I'm going to say it anyway. I asked the Lord because I had been sitting there within myself wrestling and struggling. And I said, God, what does it mean to be successful? Because somebody asked me that. But what would it mean for you to be successful? What does success look like to you? Because then that way you can paint your picture of your goal in which you're trying to reach. And then I said, well, Lord, I might have a vision in my head of what it means to be successful. But God, what do you mean for? What does it mean in your talk, in your will for my life to be successful? And I started thinking about the money and the houses and the cars and this and that, which we often do. We often equate success with money and things that we can buy and happiness. That's what we usually, the world level measure of success is. And then God showed me somebody who had all this. He took me to the rich young ruler who came to Jesus and saw all that he was doing and said, yo, Jesus, how can I be down? You know, I've got money, I've got this, I got the finest that, I got the cars, I got the houses, I got the bling, I got all this. Jesus was like, okay, take all that you have, give it away to charity, and follow me. He was like, no. Bible said he turned around angry. Like, you got some nerve. All this stuff, all this wealth I've amassed over all these years, and you gonna tell me to give it all away and follow you? You're crazy. And then Jesus said something very important. He said, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and yet lose his soul? So while we're busy being successful in life, we failed in the afterlife. So when I said, Lord, well then what does it mean to be successful? He said, salvation. He said, you're already a success because I called you one. Because you answered the call. You accepted me as your Lord and Savior. You confessed. You're living that life. And now because you're spiritually rich, I'm going to show you how to be naturally rich. See, it's not that we can't have stuff because we get it twisted. The Lord called me to be poor. Whatever. You follow that calling if you want. I haven't been called to that area in life. I remember taking the spiritual gifts test, and that's one of the gifts, being poor. What? You don't know how many people are gifted? If that's the case, I never understood that. I used to look at that like, why is that a gift? To be humble, the gift of, yes, it was the gift of poverty. What? How is that reflective of the God I serve? How, if he comes that I might have life and that I might have it more abundantly, how is poverty a gift from God? Now, being humble in what I have and learning to be content with that which I have, as Paul says, is one thing. My desire is to be poor. No. Jesus, bring me back. Where was I at? Lord, Jesus, help me. All right, reasons to praise God. Reasons. I think I'm hyping myself up enough. I need to dial it down a notch. One, see, I told you I got this. The Almighty God is worthy of our praise and our worship. Said, let the word do the work. Psalm 18:3 says, I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. I will call upon him. Why will I call upon him? Because he's worthy to be praised. Then I can be saved from my enemies. There's reason enough to praise him because he'll save me from my enemies. Yeah. Revelation 5:11-12 says, then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000s and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing, even in heaven. Tens of thousands times thousands and thousands of angels are praising him and declaring that he is worthy. They're worshiping him because he is God. They're praising him for what he's done. We praise him also for what he's done. It's called thanksgiving. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Enter his courts with praise. Thank you for what you've done, God. Praise and thanksgiving is verbalized faith. It's spoken faith. Mm-hmm. When we thank God after the fact, it's gratitude. Mm-hmm. And when we thank him beforehand, it's a show of our faith. I'm going to thank you for something you haven't given me yet. Why? Because I know you're a faithful God to give it to me. I know you're faithful to come through. Feel like I can wake up in the morning, just roll over, look at my wife and say thank you for dinner and this breakfast time. Why? Because she's shown in her actions and her faithfulness that she'll feed us every day. Does God not take care of us, clothe us, and give us everything else? So we should be able to wake up in the morning and say, God, I thank you for this day. Because this is the day that you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Mm-hmm. When we pray our Father, would you give us this day our daily bread? We're already thanking him for what he's provided for us to eat. Mm-hmm. We are called to praise and worship God. 1 Peter 2:5, and also talked about earlier that we were living stones, that we were a royal priesthood, called to proclaim the praises of him who called us out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Psalm 150:6, like I already said, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Told us twice, praise the Lord. We have breath. Praise changes us. Jeremiah 2:5. In the New Living Translation says this. This is what the Lord says. It is written, what do your ancestors find wrong with me that led them to stray so far from me? They worshiped worthless idols only to become worthless themselves. Wait a minute. Pastor Chris, what they got to do with anything? He was rolling in one direction and you just turned to somewhere else. Yes, because we need to understand, in other words, when we worship worthless idols or worthless things, we become worthless. Mm-hmm. We become like what we worship. Worship doesn't always mean we bow down to something and we give it glory and honor, but worship can be those things that take precedent in our lives over our God. If we worship superficial things, we become superficial. If we worship perverted things, we become perverted. If we worship evil things, we become evil. But if we worship the true and living God, guess what? We become godly. Okay, so let's break it down a little bit more. If I stay on my cell phone 24/7, I'm no good to no one. Uh-oh. Yeah, because I'm worshiping my phone. See, I don't see it that way, but I am. Because my cell phone is now taking precedence over everything else in my life. If my car is the best thing in my life, and oh, I love my car. I wash it every day. Look at it shine. Look at it sparkle. Keep it looking nice. Oh man, this car is all that. This is the best car ever. You see how I clean the wheels and wax it out? Where you live at? Oh, with my grandma. But my car look nice. But I don't have my own. And I'm barely getting by. But did you see my car? It makes me mad. We were living, and these people were in one of the Section 8 houses and had these two nice cars. And every day, shall I tell you, I was mad. Every time I see them cars parked out, I was mad. How y'all living in that house with them cars? Don't make no sense. I'm talking about nice cars. High-end Lexuses, tinted windows, rims, everything. And you walking out of Section 8 house. I got a problem with you. I know, folks, that's all right. They gonna, y'all know, every week I tell y'all where to send the emails to. Y'all got it. But you don't understand. You're right, I don't understand. Because if you could put all that money into those cars, investing in something that depreciates by 20% the minute you take it off the lot. Come back. Mm-hmm. Oh, Lord Jesus, help me. 2 Corinthians 3:18 in the New Living Translation. Says, so all of us who had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we are changed into his glorious image. In other words, as we continue to worship God more, we become godly. Our thoughts begin to change. As we seek after, like I told you, Sahara, as you begin to seek after God, as you begin to fill yourself with more of him, you'll see that the old you will start disappearing and you'll be transformed into something new. The things that used to bother you won't bother you like they used to, because now you're looking at it from a new perspective. Even have a little more patience with a little man there, as we gonna teach him how to sit still sometimes. Instead of being set loose, he on 10 right now. He always on 10. I think brother, he go from 10 to sleep. He just no in between. We gonna work on Alpha. Pray for him. But we love him. Isaiah 61:3 says, as to all who mourn in Israel, he will give a crown of beauty for ashes, a joyous blessing instead of mourning, festive praise instead of despair. In their righteousness, they will be like great oaks, and the Lord has planted for his own glory. In other words, as we continue, Lord God, he's going to change us as we change. He will change our mourning into dancing. He'll change our depression into praise. So we'll take off the garment of despair and we'll put on we'll take off the cloak of despair, excuse me, and we'll put on a garment of praise. Praise and worship ushers in the manifested presence of God. Psalm 22:3, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabits the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted and thou did deliver them. They cried to thee and they were delivered. They trusted and they were not confounded. Like we always say, the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. O thou that inhabits the praises of Israel. Israel is his people. God inhabits his praises. When I begin to praise God, he shows up. Psalm 107:32 says, let them exalt him also in the congregation of the people and praise him in the assembly of the elders. Guess what? Let him exalt him also in the congregation of the people and praise him in the assembly of the elders. Can't take place at home by yourself. What? There are times when you need to come out your house and go to church. Stop all that. I watch on Facebook or I turn the TV in and I get my word there. I understand there are some people who can't get out of the house and don't have the ability sometimes. For a while there, before my grandmother in North Carolina passed, there was a time where she couldn't really get out of the house that way. And so that was her church. And, you know, there were times when she could, but it was a struggle because there was a lot to do to get her out there into the church. And because of different health reasons, she could not be there as long as she would probably like or enter in as she would. I get that. I know that people have situations, but there are some of those who are able-bodied and we go anywhere we want on any other time. But for some reason on Sunday morning, all of a sudden, I don't have time for it. Or even on a Saturday morning, I don't have time for it. Or Wednesday night, I don't have time for it. All of a sudden, everything else becomes a priority but God, right? Until your life starts falling apart and then you want to say, why, God? Praise defeats our enemy. Out of the mouth of babes and infants, thou hast ordained strength because of thine enemies. Thou might still the enemy and the avenger. Psalm 8:2. Out of the mouths of children, God has ordained strength. In other words, let the kids praise him. Why? Because the enemies would look at the children praising them and say, wait a minute, why are they singing? That he might shut the mouths of the enemies and those that would come to do us harm. Oh, one of my favorite scriptures, I used to quote this a lot during praise and worship, and I don't think anybody ever really paid attention to what I said even back then. Psalm 149:5-6 says, let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouths and a two-edged sword in their hands. In other words, let the high praises of God be in your mouth. And when you're clapping, it's like a double-edged sword to go against the works of the enemy. It's like you're forming a double-edged sword because your praise is declaring some things. Your praise is breaking yokes. Your praise is destroying some hard areas in your life. Your praise is stirring some things up and stirring you up and stirring some people around you up. And there's sometimes when it seems like the world won't praise and I got to praise by myself, and that's all right. Psalm 18:3 once again says, I call on the Lord who is worthy of praise, and he saved me from my enemies. In other words, my praise will put evil to flight. When I start praising God, my problems have to run away. They have to flee. They have to get on out the way because there's something going on. So how do I praise him? I praise him with my voice. Psalm 63:3 says, because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Because God is so good to us, I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to say how good he is. I'm going to give him praise. Acts 16, 25 and 26, we talk about Paul and Silas being in jail. And it says, at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. Now my praise is going to set somebody else free. Right. And suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loose. I had to look back at that, and I said to myself, because we used to always say, well, why is it that none of the prisoners ran out of the prison when the doors and the bands were open? Because I wonder if that description was more of a description of the spiritual nature of those that were in bondage, because they heard the praise and the prayers of the two who were in there with them in the midst of it. And then all of a sudden, all of their doors of captivity in their spirit and all of the bands that had them bound, the anger, the depression, the despair, the bitterness became loose, because right. somebody else in the midst of the same situation they were in decided that instead of focusing on the doom and gloom, I'm going to focus on the sun always shining in spite of the clouds. That at midnight, when it was darkest in the dungeon, in the cage, in the bottom, in the pit of despair, they decided to give God praise.
All right.
Mm. Earthquake shook the foundation. Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, yes. Oh, God, I'm getting excited up here. Psalm 95 and 6. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. We are worshiping. We're praising him. We're giving him glory. As I sit here and look at this, I'm starting to miss somewhat as we would call it, the old church, where they would just praise and just be some foot stomping and hand clapping. And I think we've come into a generation or a time within our generation where we've been, yes, throwing out those vain traditions, but we've been tossing out the good stuff with it. And if we're not careful, we'll forget where God brought us from, because we'll throw it away and we'll neglect it like it doesn't matter. Like all night prayer doesn't matter. Yeah, all night prayer doesn't matter, because sometimes, yes, it does take all night to get through your situation. Stop with all the, we're going to pray until, well, we'll get an answer. And but if we don't get an answer by 10 o'clock, then we'll just have to reschedule for another time. No, I remember sitting in the annex at Sanctuary Church of God in Christ, waking up at night sweating with drool on my face because I was laying on them red leather chairs up in the upper room waiting because they decided to have all night prayer. I remember Mother Doris and them cooking bacon for breakfast the next morning because I had to be in the church all night long, wake up face all crinkled, wrinkled and everything else, and hot and sweaty and just like, oh mommy, can we go home now? No, we ain't finished praying. What you mean we ain't finished praying? We about to eat breakfast, but we're gonna pray for a little while longer before we head back out. What?
Oh Lord.
You say that to somebody in church now? No, we're not staying tonight at the church. It's not comfortable there.
Oh Lord.
Oh! Man, I done set myself up with something, didn't I, Holy Spirit? I hear you talking. Mm-hmm. Woo! Praise him with music. Mm-hmm. Psalm 150, back in that scripture again, man, that whole Psalm 150 is just a dangerous psalm. Oh, I love it. 153-6, praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. See, this is where I'm missing the musician right now. Because, see, I'd be going in right now and have to do, yeah, right. Yeah, okay, I'm going to have to do it in my own head. Forgive me, y'all. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the string instruments and the organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high-sounding cymbals. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Woo! Ah, yeah, I don't know about y'all. Angel, get yourself hyped. Get ready, baby girl. You coming. Mm-hmm. With my emotions. It says, come, Psalm 47, 1-3. Come clap your hands. New Living Translation says, come everyone, clap your hands. Shout to God with joyful praise. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is the great King of all the earth. He subdues the nations before us, putting our enemies beneath our feet. Oh, clap your hands, all ye people, and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Joyful praise. Woo! Victory. Seems like Christians nowadays, it's too many of us don't have victory. We say we have victory, but we don't look like it. Yay, I'm victorious. Yes, we win. See, I get it. I ain't about to just the huck a buck and get up here and dance and jive for no reason. But it's something about when you get so worked up and when you get so caught up in the goodness of God that your feet begin to tap. And it's like, I don't want to control it. Or when I begin to rock side to side, when I think about the goodness of Jesus, when I begin to just lift my hands, Lord, because I thank you. When I'm just over there crying for, I don't know, I can't figure it out. But when I'm just thinking about how good God has been, what he's brought me through, how he's brought me out of so many situations, when he's taking me from danger seen and unseen, when the doctor said this and God said no, when the doctor said this and God said no, when the diagnosis with this, when God said to be healed, when I was falling apart and Jesus said be made whole, when I was living in sin and dying on the inside and God said get up and live, and I think about these things, how can I not praise him? How can I not get excited? How can I get ready to dance? How can I not cry a tear or have a smile on my face or think about the joy and the goodness of Jesus in the land of the living? That the song says, when I think of his goodness and all he's done for me, my soul cries out hallelujah.
Yes.
With my whole life, that's how I praise him. With my whole life. Daughter, get ready. That's how I praise him. With my whole life. 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, so whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. I give God glory in all I do. And wherever I do, whatever we do, we should do it to the glory of God. On that job that we don't like sometimes, we do so to the glory of God. To the part in our life, I ain't fussing, I just want you to get hype, I want you to get happy, I want you to do this thing. I tell you the other day, man, it was just beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right?
Mm-hmm. For God, because he's been good to you.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, he's been so good to you, daughter, but oh, believe me when I tell you, from before day one, the enemy tried to take you out. Told mommy that you were dead. Go ahead and have let us take you out because you miscarried. There's nothing there. Let us get you here. Take these pills and finish the process. It'll come out in the bathroom. Mommy said, no, I don't believe that. Day later, or was it the day before? We was at the diner and a young man sitting at the diner began to prophesy to mommy and told her, your child gonna live, that the enemy's gonna try to take your child out. This was the day before, excuse me. Before anything even happened, before we went to the doctor, mommy sat there and believed on the promises of God and began to praise him right there in front of the doctor when the doctor said no. Because God had already told her, you're supposed to be here, you're going to happen. See, when we sat there and mommy was trying to give birth to you, the enemy was trying to stop it then. Said, no, you're not going to be able to have this child because you just won't open up enough and we can't figure out why. Every time mommy had a contraction, your heart rate dropped so low, they didn't know what was going on. Said, we think we're going to lose it. We need to go in and have the surgery right now. Said, because the cord was wrapped in a place where every time mommy's muscles contracted, began to choke you. I saw them when they pulled you out. They literally unwrapped it from your neck. See, don't think it's strange. Saw you before you were born in the church dancing. Never once did we make you dance. Never once before then did we tell you you were going to. Came to church one Saturday to clean. Started playing the music. You were in the front of the sanctuary by yourself giving God praise. You had lost your mind. People were in the back, literally, looking through the doors like, oh my goodness. What is this little girl doing? 3 years old. Ain't know no better, just giving God praise. There was no fear. There was no nothing. The devil is a liar. Why is he a liar? Because God has called you to praise him. It's not about what we want. It's about what God wants. You want those doors in your life to open up? Be obedient to God. Girl, when I seen you dance the other day, I'm gonna tell y'all something, made me mad. Made me mad because she, don't take this the wrong way. But when she started working on it, she wasn't really working on it, you know? It was just kind of like, let me do this because I'm tired of my daddy nagging me about dancing. Okay? And when she, and I said, well, you gotta show me something. And when she did, it was so hard for me not to smile, cause I was so angry, cause I'm like, is this good? And she ain't even trying. What in the world might happen if she put everything she had into it? I don't know. And I'm not fussing. I know you think I'm fussing. I ain't fussing. I'm trying to encourage you. I'm encouraging you. Girl, you got it. You got a gift. You got a gift. That's right. Tell her, Alpha. Angel. You ready? You gonna praise him? You gonna dance? You gonna move this out the way? No? All right, you go on.
You tell them.
What'd you say now?
For them to move up.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's all right.
Somebody put a praise on me.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Woo, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Ah. Put a praise on it. Something about praise changed the whole direction of the message. Because literally, when I saw her doing the dance, I wasn't even going to preach about that today. That wasn't what I felt was called to do. And when I saw her rehearsing on it, said, change it. Said, don't put her up there at the beginning, put her on there at the end. Don't worry about what the program said. Put a praise on it. Put a praise on it. In the middle of your situation, put a praise on it. When it seems like I should be crying and down and depressed, put a praise on it. When I feel like my world is just crumbling all around me, put a praise on it. See, it don't make sense. So I say it all the time. I'm going to say it again because I feel it in my spirit. It don't make common sense to put a praise on it when all hell is breaking loose. But it makes all the godly sense in the world to put a praise on it when it seems like my life is down, when I shouldn't have my hands lifted up, when I shouldn't be saying thank you, Jesus, when I should not be claiming the victory. I gotta put a praise on it. Whew. When my legs are sore and I don't feel like dancing, I gotta put a praise on it. When my heart is heavy, and it seems like a smile is just hard to put on my face, I gotta put a praise on it.
All right.
When I feel like giving that person a piece of my mind, I gotta put a praise on it. When my feelings been hurt and I feel like I've been used and abused and my heart is crushed, I gotta put a praise on it. Because there's just something about staying in my situation that I don't want to stay in, that praise will help alleviate what's going on. Woo! Oh, when I think of how good God is. When I think about all I've been through. See, I can't think for you. I don't know what you've been through. Don't nobody know you like you, what you've been through, every battle that you fought, every victory that you got over. When you can look back over your life and realize, God, you were there in the midst. When I thought I was by myself, God, you were there in the midst of my situation. See, I don't know about you, but when I get to thinking about all the things that I've been through, when I think about where I'm at right now, how can I not praise him? How can I not praise him? And when I think about, even when I think about some of you, I don't know your life story, but just looking at you, I know you've been through some things. Because you can't live as long as you live and I'll go through something. And when I think about, because you're God's people and you're in God's house, that something kept bringing you back, that you had to go through something because you keep coming back to give him praise. Woo-wee! Oh, thank you, Jesus. Go ahead and play. Oh, yeah, just getting off. My God. Right. Hallelujah. See, when I understand, when I was a young praise and worship leader, I used to think it was the music that caused the praise to break out. But then when I started thinking about how good my God has been, when I started to really just let the defenses drop, when I started to not worry about what the others was going to think, because I didn't quite understand how I was about to lose my mind. See, when I got to that place, I began to understand that it wasn't me responding to the music. It was the music responding to my praise. See, my dance is my dance, regardless if the song is playing or not. My joy is my joy, no matter what my situation may look like. My praise is my praise, because my God is great and greatly to be praised. My praise is mine, because he declared, let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the cymbals, the loud sounding cymbals. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Whatever you got to do to get yourself psyched up. Woo! We've allowed it to become a show, to become a competition. We got the best two-step. I don't care if I dance off beat, look funny to you, strange, spin around, fall down. If it's real, it's real. If the Spirit of God moves me, I'm gonna move. That's right, Alpha. I see you, bud. And that's exactly what we got to do. I see Uncle Will over there clapping his hands, and the children are following. We got to show them what praise is, what real praise is, what real Holy Ghost worship looks like. We got to sometimes allow them to see us going through so they can see how God brings us out. So they can understand that when their life gets hard, they don't have to turn to suicide. They don't have to go to Google. They can go to God. He knows more anyway. We've got to show them how to live right. We've got to show them that they can fall down and that, yes, they can get up. I've seen mommy do it. I've seen daddy do it. I've seen grandma do it. Yes, there are some things in the church that have to go. But then there are some things in the church that needs to continue to grow. We've got to get our praise back. We've got to get back to the heart of worship. We've got to make prayer a priority in our lives. We've got to keep God first. Because in these last and evil days, everything in creation will come to slay us from the Creator. So we bless him and we give him praise. If you don't know Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sins, simply call on him as he says in his word, and you will be saved. Just simply say, Jesus, save me now. Forgive me of my sins and make me right. I want to be whole again. I want to dance. I want to praise. I want to worship you, Lord God. Go ahead, Alpha. Go get your praise on, little man. Ah, Alpha. When can I get you to come? Can you come here? I didn't even have to ask. He just coming on here. All right. Come on, buddy. Praise God together. See, this is the young man I'm always talking about. For those of you that are watching, here's what I decree. Maybe not at this pulpit, but in the future, this young man's going to preach. This man's going to get up, and he's going to declare to each and every one of us in the world who God is and what he can do. And me, we in agreement, mommy, and is that all right if I prophesy that over him? This is a man of God. Uh-huh. Yes, this is a man of God. This is a man of God in training. And he's going to praise him. And he's going to preach the word in season and out of season. And he's going to be filled and led by the Holy Spirit. Amen? Can I get a high five on that? All right. Go ahead and praise him on back to your seat. Go on in. See, he follows directions. I'm talking about. Amen. Giving God glory and honor. Yes. And praise for today. Felt like a rough one. But that's alright. Praise Him. Praise Him for His goodness. Praise Him for His mercy. Praise Him for His excellence.